Hello everyone, in this video we will do the daily current affairs analysis of the news items which were on news on 6th of October 2021. So what are the topics that we will discuss? First is the World Airlines commit to net zero carbon emissions by 2050. It is important for prelims and mains. Next is the changes to Forest Conservation Act. After that we will discuss Global Coral Reef Monitoring Network and its report. Next is the Physics Nobel Award 2021, Swechha program launched by Telangana government. Next is the Denmark legally binds farmers to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So World Airlines commit to net zero carbon emissions by 2050. It is important for GS paper 3 and topic is conservation and pollution related issues. So why it is in news? The International Air Transport Association 77th Annual General Meeting approved a resolution for the global air transport industry to achieve a net zero carbon emissions by 2050. This commitment will align with the Paris Agreement goal for global warming not to exceed 1.5 degrees centigrade. Challenges ahead. Achieving net zero emissions will be a huge challenge. The aviation industry must progressively reduce its emissions while accommodating the growing demand of a that is eager to fly. To be able to serve the needs of the 10 billion people expected to fly in 2050, at least 1.8 gigatons of carbon must be abated in that year. Moreover, the net zero commitment implies that a cumulative total of 21.2 gigatons of carbon will be abated between now and 2050. The resolution demands that all industry stakeholders commit to addressing the environmental impact of their policies, products, and activities with concrete actions and clear timelines, including fuel-producing companies bringing large-scale, cost-competitive, sustainable aviation fuels SAF to the market, governments and air navigation service providers eliminating inefficiencies in air traffic management and airspace infrastructure, aircraft and engine manufacturers producing radically more efficient airframe and propulsion technologies, airport operators providing the needed infrastructure to supply SAF at cost and in a cost-effective manner. Which countries have announced net zero targets? In 2019, the New Zealand government passed the Zero Carbon Act, which committed the country to zero carbon emissions by 2050. The UK's parliament passed legislation requiring the government to reduce the UK's net emissions of greenhouse gases by 100%. US President Joe Biden announced that the country will cut its greenhouse gas emissions by at least 50% below 2005 levels by 2030. World War Zero was launched in 2019 to bring together unlikely allies on climate change and with the goal of reaching net zero carbon emissions in the country by 2050. The European Union plan Fit for 55, the European Commission has asked all of its 27 member countries to cut emissions by 55% below 1990 levels by 2030. China announced that it would become net zero by the year 2060 and that it would not allow its emissions to peak beyond what they are in 2030. What about India? India, the world's third biggest emitter of greenhouse gases after the US and China, is the only major player holding out. India has been arguing that instead of opening up a parallel discussion on net zero targets outside of the Paris Agreement framework, countries must focus on delivering on what they have already promised. India's concerns over the next 2 to 3 decades. India's emissions are likely to grow at the fastest pace in the world as it presses for higher growth to pull hundreds of millions of people out of poverty. No amount of afforestation or reforestation would be able to compensate for the increased emissions. Most of the carbon removal technologies right now are either unreliable or very expensive. What does net zero mean? Net zero, which is also referred to as carbon neutrality, does not mean that a country would bring down its emissions to zero. that would be gross zero, which means reaching a state where there are no emissions at all, a scenario hard to comprehend. Basically, net zero is a state in which a country's emissions are compensated by absorption and removal of greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. So why countries are focusing a lot on greenhouse gas emissions and focusing a lot on climate change? Because this concept of greenhouse gas emissions is linked to a lot of many other factors. Because when the amount of greenhouse gases increases in the atmosphere of the earth, so the amount of carbon dioxide in the earth's atmosphere increases, which leads to warming of the earth's temperature, increasing the temperature of the earth, which also leads to warming of the temperature of both the land as well as the sea surface. The temperature of the sea water also increases, which in turn leads to faster melting of the glaciers and the thawing of permafrost at a rapid pace, which has multiple negative consequences. For example, in the short run, it will lead to instances of higher floods because of the melting of glaciers, which will cause concerns like a threat to food security and waterborne diseases. And also in the longer run, it will lead to higher instances of water scarcity, droughts, drying up of rivers, changing of the rivers' courses, soil erosion instances will increase, which will also lead to other issues like higher instances of landslides, avalanches will increase, and also a lot of population lives in the permafrost region. And because of the higher rate of melting of the permafrost region, their whole livelihood, their social, economic, and political livelihood, environmental things there will get disturbed. So that is why climate change, the focus on climate change is very, very important. And the most important aspect of climate change is the emission of the greenhouse gases. And that is why countries all over the world, whether developing or developed, are focusing a lot on reducing the greenhouse gas emissions, which will ultimately reduce the level of the level of increase of the temperature or warming up of Earth's surface. Because when the Earth's temperature increases at a rapid pace as compared to the pre-industrial levels, it has many negative consequences. So that is why this topic has been a major cause of concern and major cause or major topic of discussion in all over the world. And that is why India has been also focusing a lot on this, because under the Paris Agreement, we have the INDCs, intended nationally determined contributions, in which India has contributed, in which India has committed to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions and the carbon footprint. Also, it has promised to reduce and also to increase the carbon sink of its forests. And how the carbon sink can be increased? By increasing the green cover, by increasing the number of trees, by increasing the forest cover in India. And that is why increasing the forest cover is very important, because there is a statistic that a big tree absorbs almost 100 kgs of carbon dioxide in a year. So when a large number of forest trees are grown and forests are created, the percentage of forest area is expanded. So it will automatically enhance the carbon sink capacity of India, which will help India to fulfill its contribution commitments under the Paris Agreement. And also it will be a big step to India becoming a carbon neutral country. Okay, and that will automatically lead to reducing the pace at which the temperature of the earth is increasing, and it will automatically translate to lower instances of floods in the shorter run and lower instances of droughts in the longer run. And it will translate to higher economic productivity and higher infrastructural growth, higher social and capital development in the longer run. So that is why this topic is very, very important. Okay, so prelim thought link topics are about the climate leaders summit, what is net zero, countries committed to net zero, about the Paris Agreement. So source of this news is this. You can read the article to get a better understanding. So next is the changes to forest conservation act. It is important for GS paper 3. Topic is conservation related issues. So why it is in news? The union government has proposed certain amendments to the existing forest conservation act. Proposed changes absolve agencies involved in national security projects and border infrastructure projects from obtaining prior forest clearance from the center. Such a permission is necessary under the Forest Conservation Act, FCA. Exempt land acquired before 1980, before the FCA came into effect, by public sector bodies such as the railways. Facilitating private plantations for harvesting and exploration or extraction of oil and natural gas deep beneath forest land by drilling holes from outside the forest areas. Building in forests to ease the grievances of the individuals whose landfall in a state-specific private forest act or within the purview of dictionary meaning of forest, the ministry has proposed to allow them the right to construct structures for bona fide purposes, including forest protection measures and residential units up to an area of 250 square meter as one-time relaxation. Punishments: make offences under the modified act punishable with simple imprisonment for periods which may extend to 1 year and make it cognizable and non-bailable. It also has provisions for penal compensation to make good for the damage already done. Why were these amendments necessary? The essential tension in the FCA is that the state is committed to a principle of increasing forest cover, and this makes it harder to access land for infrastructure projects by state and private entities. Several ministries have expressed resentment on how the act was being interpreted over the right of way of railways or highways. As of today, a land holding agency, Rail, NHAI, PWD, etc., is required to take approval under the act and pay stipulated compensatory levies such as net present value, NPV, compensatory afforestation, CA, for use of such land which was originally been acquired for non-forest purposes. With more land coming under the definition of forest, it's becoming harder for state governments or private industry to use land that falls under the definition of forest for non-forestry purposes. Through the years, this has given rise to multiple instances of litigation as well as questions on the legal definition of forest. The states have been told to provide a definition of what constitutes a forest, but several haven't given them because this has political consequences. All of this has led to conflicting interpretations of the FCA throughout the years. The proposed amendment is part of a larger rationalizing of existing forest laws. So that is why social, economic and political justice needs to be equated with the concept of environmental justice, because that shouldn't be the case that while focusing a lot on economic productivity or ensuring economic justice, we neglect the concept of environmental justice. We do not pay any attention towards environmental conservation. That shouldn't be the case. And also we have to keep in mind that while conserving the environment, the economic productivity shouldn't also lose its focus. Because if we are focusing a lot on environmental justice and neglecting the economic justice totally, then the ease of living of the citizens and the per capita income of the citizens can't be enhanced in a sustainable manner. So that is why both these things, economic justice, economic productivity, as well as the concept of environmental justice or environmental conservation, must go hand in hand. And that is why this law has been in use right now. Okay. So why was the FCA enacted? The FCA first came in 1980 and was amended in 1988. While states had already notified forest land, the FCA made it necessary to get the center's permission for using such forest land for non-forestry purposes and the creation of an advisory committee to recommend such reclassification. The 1996 Supreme Court judgment in T.N. Godavarman Thirumulpad versus versus Union of India and others case paved the way for the calculating the net present value or the economic value of the portion of forest being raised for development work that had to be paid by project proponents. The creation of a compensatory afforestation fund providing non-forestry land in lieu of the dotted forest. Definition of forest. Before the 1996 Supreme Court judgment in T.N. Godavarman Thirumulpad versus Union of India and others, forest land was only that as was defined by the 1927 Forest Act. But the court included all areas which are recorded as forest in any government record, irrespective of the ownership, recognition, and classification. Prelims hot link topics. Key provisions of the FCA, Godavarman case is related to. The source of this news is The Hindu, and this is the original article. You can read it. Okay. So next is the Global Coral Reef Monitoring Network and its report. GS Paper 3, topic is conservation related issues. So why it is in news? Global Coral Reef Monitoring Network, GCRMN, has released a report on the status of coral reefs across the world. The report, the first of its kind in 13 years, underlined the catastrophic consequences of global warming but said that some coral reefs can be saved by arresting greenhouse gases. Highlights of the report. In the last decade, the world lost about 14% of its coral reefs. Threats. Ocean acidification, warmer sea temperatures, and local stressors such as overfishing, pollution, unsustainable tourism, and poor coastal management. Impact of global warming. Coral reefs across the world are under relentless stress from warming caused by climate change. Coral bleaching events caused by rise in elevated sea surface temperatures were responsible for coral loss. Loss of hard coral cover. There has been a steady decrease in hard coral cover in the last four decades since 1978 when the world lost 9% of its corals. The decrease is disconcerting because live hard coral cover is an indicator of coral reef health. Algal bloom. Algal bloom on coral ridges are a sign of stress on the structures. Since 2010, the amount of algae on the world's coral reefs has increased by about 20%. Why conserve corals? Corals occupy less than 1% of the ocean floor, but over 1 billion people benefit directly from the reefs. The value of goods and services provided by coral reefs is estimated to be $2.7 trillion per year. This includes $36 billion in coral reef tourism. The net economic value of the world's coral reefs could be nearly tens of billions of dollars per year. Challenges ahead. Persistent rise of land and sea temperatures is a threat to corals. The survival of corals is likely to drop below 50% if sea surface temperatures increase by 1 degree, which is directly linked to the amount of greenhouse gases emitted or the amount of carbon dioxide present in the Earth's atmosphere. Because as the amount of carbon dioxide or the level of GHG gases emitted increases, so the temperature of the Earth's surface and also the temperature of the sea surface, sea water increases, which directly or indirectly has many negative consequences, like reducing the coral reefs, reducing the expansion of coral reefs. And also, as we already discussed, in short-term instances like floods, and in the long-term, drying up of rivers, droughts, and soil erosion, and issues like that. Okay, so that is why this concept is very, very important. So the all of the world's reefs will bleach by the end of the century unless the world acts together to reduce carbon emissions. What is bleaching? Basically, bleaching is when the corals expel a certain algae known as zooxanthellae, which lives in the tissues of the coral in a symbiotic relationship. About 90% of the energy of the coral is provided by the zooxanthellae, which are endowed with chlorophyll and other pigments. They are responsible for the yellow or reddish brown colors of the host coral. In addition, the zooxanthellae can live as endosymbionts with jellyfish also. When a coral bleaches, it does not die but comes pretty close to it. Some of the corals may survive the experience and recover once the sea surface temperature returns to normal levels. So, source of this news is source of this news is Down to Earth, and this is the article, original article. You can read that. So next is the Physics Nobel Award 2020. It is a prelims specific topic. So three scientists, Shukoro Manabe 90 and Claus Hazelman 89 and Giorgio Parisi 73, have been awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics 2021. This is the first time climate scientists have been awarded the Physics Nobel. So from this you can gauge the importance of climate change initiative. So Manabe and Hazelman were awarded for their work in the physical modeling of Earth's climate, quantifying variability and reliably predicting the global warming. Parisi was awarded for the discovery of the interplay of disorder and fluctuations in physical systems from atomic to planetary scales. Manabe, starting in the 1960s, demonstrated how increases in the amount of carbon dioxide in atmosphere would increase global temperatures, laying the foundations for current climate models. About a decade later, Hazelman created a model that linked weather and climate, helping explain why climate models can be reliable despite the seemingly chaotic nature of the weather. He also developed ways to look for signs of human influence on the climate. Parisi built a deep physical and mathematical model that made it possible to understand complex systems in fields such as mathematics, biology, neuroscience, and machine learning. Last year, scientists Roger Penrose, Reinhard Genzel, and Andrea Ghez won the Nobel Physics Prize for their discoveries concerning black holes. So this is the original article. You can read that. Next is the Swechha program. It is a prelims specific topic and it is an awareness drive on menstruation launched recently by the Andhra Pradesh government. It has been launched in all the government schools and colleges. Under the program, sanitary napkins would be provided to over 10 lakh students studying in classes 7 to 12. So this is the original article, you can study. Next is the Denmark legally binds farmers to reduce GHG emissions. Prelims specific topic. The Parliament of Denmark has approved a plan to reduce greenhouse gas emissions in agriculture and forestry sectors by 55 and 65% respectively by 2030. The emission target reduction is based on the GHG emission level of 1990. This will be legally binding. Background. The European Union has binding climate and energy targets for its members that include Denmark by 2030. Each member has to adopt national energy and climate plans for 2021-2030 under this. Denmark had adopted this plan in December 2019. The latest target is a part of this plan. So this is the original article. You can read it for getting further clarity on this topic. So thanks a lot for watching this analysis video. Have a nice day.